Or an office like judge. I might be willing, I would be open to the idea of running for the office of judge, where the office of judge administers a lot of sentences that I absolutely don't think any socialist could affirm, on the basis of getting into that position and immediately breaking the terms of that position and being impeached, basically. But, you know, it would be a subject of debate for socialists. You also said, how do we relate to these campaigns? I think the Socialist Party should, as I said a bit about, I think the Socialist Party should relate to these campaigns as an opportunity to organize the working class, right, in the most general way. Through the Socialist Party, which I think is an important part, but also in union struggles, in immigrant struggles, in struggles with police, and so forth. And one more thing I would like to address, another analysis for why Hillary was defeated, because there's been a lot of analysis that invoke the working class in various ways. I have a bit of knowledge about the state of Wisconsin. In the state of Wisconsin, it's inarguable that the reason Hillary Clinton won was because the working class did not come to vote for her. In particular, the Democratic vote turnout fell to the point where the Republican turnout, which didn't really rise that much, wasn't enough to win. So, how do we explain that Hillary Clinton is not president? Well, her issues, her campaign did not represent the interests of the working class. But a special factor in this has been the labor unions. In the state of Wisconsin, Rock County is actually the county that Paul Ryan is from, which he represents. It used to have a GM plant. The GM plant closed. And it was one of actually a small number of counties where working class voters did shift to Republicans. In this election, but it's a very small number of counties that are like that. But this comes after 30 or 40 years of deindustrialization in which the union leadership has cooperated with the Democratic Party the whole time. It has not led resistance to the bosses. It cooperated with GM up to the point that they closed down the factory. They just wanted to make the corporations profitable. Actually, that goes back a lot further with the labor unions and the Democratic Party. For the labor unions to fight, they have to fight against the capitalists. They're taking something from the capitalists. That's not going to go lightly. The Democratic Party is only going to let that happen if it's cheaper price than something else. You know, if it's better to give a concession than to let the strike succeed. If it's better to give a concession than to, have production stop, then they'll give it. But I think what it means is that as a working class movement, as a socialist movement, we need to be active in unions and also organizing all the people who've lost their unions and, you know, the last 30 years, and that means opposing those labor bureaucrats who are so closely tied to the Democratic Party and give them a lot of money that they really should not be taking from the members for that purpose.
Okay, we got a, if anybody else that hasn't spoken, I'd like to...
I have something to say.
Yeah, where's Jane? Jane Marcus Delgado.
I'm not with any political party, but... I just wanted to comment on what the Movement for Socialism gentleman said, because I think, and I came in late, so if I'm saying something that was already said, I apologize. I think that this is an unprecedented moment in my lifetime in terms of organization and social movements and people rising up and getting organized. And I've seen it among people, young people, people who never participated in politics. This election, I think, has driven people to a level of mobilization that we haven't seen. And you know, they say President Trump said, make America great again. Well, he did make America great again because he made everybody so angry that we've now had the biggest marches that we've had, at least in my lifetime, since, you know, I was very involved in the Central America movements. I mean, all those way back when movements, when there were big movements in politics, and I've never seen anything like this. And so the question is, who is going to, and Bernie Sanders, I think, also had a huge grassroots movement. So the question is, who's going to take that energy and that organization and take it from being a spontaneous gathering to being something that you can systematize into political and social change? And, you know, I mean, we went to meetings the other day. I went to meetings that had been organized nationally by the ACLU, well, the ACLU is doing a nice job, you know, doing their kind of organizing. But I think that the trick for socialists and really for anybody is, how are you going to take the energy? You can get, you know, thousands of people to go to the airport. You can get thousands of people to go out on the street for one thing or another. How are you going to capture that energy and channel it into electoral politics, if that's what you're interested in, or into social change, or even into pressuring things? I think the reason that the healthcare bill, and you may have talked about this before I got here, the reason the healthcare bill was defeated is because people went out to town halls. Yeah. And they said, if you're going to vote for this, then don't bother coming home. And I think that we, you know, we know that the right wing pushed their side of things, but we also know that there was a tremendous resistance to it on the part of the people. And so I just think this is an opportune moment for that kind of change in this country. You had to take somebody like Donald Trump to drive people to that. And now they woke up. And, you know, my challenge would be, okay, now that they're awake, what are you going to do? What are you going to do with it? How are you going to actually make it translate into something concrete?
That's the million-dollar question, so it's going to go immediately.
Well, I have advice for socialist organizers. You should sort of be involved in all of these groups with people ranging from moderate liberals to, you know, these people who've never been involved. Your voice has to be in there because you have a lot of experience. You know about strategies and tactics. You know how hard it is to actually do the nuts and bolts of organizing. And United Front, right? That's, you know, but that, it takes you away from the sort of the disciplined sort of party organizing on your socialist program, right? That would be like coming to meetings with a whole lot of people who don't agree with you right now.
Well,
could I just intervene?
It's an old idea.
Well,
on that offer, on Wednesday, Selma has a panel on elections. Could the social, it's basically the Democrats' perspective
the
that is there.
Could
we be invited to have that perspective on the panel?
There are people in my group who would be open to talking about that.
Okay.
I can't guarantee you a result. That event actually is being postponed, it seems.
Oh.
Because there's a
better opportunity to.
So there's more time to talk about it. But there are people in my group who want socialist values and principles represented within my group, and you can feel the tension, right? Like, oh, I don't want to talk about that. Oh, why be divisive, right? Mm-hmm. And you know, my position is we have to talk about it. But, you know, this is a fairly well-off suburb, and like Jane said, most of the people hadn't been active before, so it is quite a moment.
It's quite a moment, and I do think it's important that those with more progressive ideas be at the table for this moment. One, just thoughts about the healthcare stuff. I mean, I was glad that the Affordable Care Act survived as a stopgap, but my fear is that through the organizing and the energy, it can come across as it survived and it sort of proved that it's the best way forward. Like there's a potential that be picked up. And part of that happening is if there aren't more progressive voices at the table saying, I will push fully to not have this thing fall apart right now, as long as we say that universal healthcare has got to be the eventual way forward, and that a truly progressive plan here is going to be a single payer sort of system. So I think we make a mistake if we're not at least in those conversations.
I mean, responding to your comment, yeah, I think that this is a tremendous moment. And we can thank Donald Trump for unifying the country and opposition to himself. The question is, what are we for? We know what or who we're against. And I think that we can come to an agreement if we put aside the question of what's acceptable to the Democrats. If we say, what do we need at this moment of history? I mean, economically, we need free education, which in the 21st century means including higher education. That's part of what we need. We need free medical health, medical care, which actually most people have in the industrialized world. We need free transportation, free housing. Free housing may sound radical, but that's because we don't have enough housing to go around in this country. We can produce enough housing to go around. We need free clean energy, which we can produce. And that takes a federal government program, which can be funded by taking back the money that the rich has been stolen. And, that's not a program that we can get as a social democratic reform, because capitalism is in decline. Capitalism, the question for the capitalists is how much they're going to take from us. So that's a step towards a socialist transformation. We need to defend equal rights that are needed to get to that program. And perhaps most controversially, we need a public banking system, because otherwise the financial system is going to simply pull the plug on anything we try to do. I'm hoping we could unify around at least a good part of that program. And as I say, I think that you need a mass movement that takes this program to every battle and says there are many outrages. We're going to fight each of these outrages, but we're going to fight that with a single program. And the electoral arm is going to represent that program and turn elections exactly into referenda on the program. And so what? Initially, you might be getting 20 or 25% of the vote, but that will be a step forward. And eventually, we'll be getting far more. So that's what I would propose people come together, and that means by 2018, by next November of next year, there may be an alternative between the Republicans, to the Republicans and the Democrats.
Yeah, so the concept of the United Front, I think, is very important as a matter of defense. To join everyone who's willing to defend those who are threatened, especially by the state, by the police, by immigration forces, but also by the far right, other folks who require defense. And that's in those issues, they're very urgent. They require unity in defense. At the same time, in those circumstances, there's always a question of what tactics to employ. And there will be some tactics that are, at minimum, say, embarrassing to Democratic city politicians, but oftentimes are problematic for even very well-meaning progressives in terms of confrontations with, for example, immigration, ICE, right? So in a united front, you're not always doing the same thing, and there has to be sort of debate, and we have to be very open that we're not just joining all together, but we are joining respectively as socialists, revolutionary socialists, and so forth. But there's a larger question of kind of unity of the left. Hadn't it be better that all the progressives who are the left of a certain position, come together and be in the same discussion? Well, we are in the same discussion. But how I would respond to that is that it's not really a correct, unfortunately, interpretation of how politics works that you can join in a group and influence it to pull it your way. In fact, if you join an organization like the Democratic Party, you don't influence it to pull it your way. You give them confidence because they know they've got you. And then that makes it safer for them to go exactly the opposite direction. And that's what's happened with social movement after social movement after social movement that buried itself in the Democratic Party. So in terms of unity, we are in fact a society divided by classes. It is a society based on wealth that is taken from people who work and is concentrated in the hands of capitalists. And what that means is that there's a basic division of interests, and that the basic division on which we should base our unity is fighting as a class, so that it should be a working class politics. And I think I can support this with all kinds of historical cases. If you go back through history, the times when the working people have made great advances have been when they've been organized as a class and when they've had an organizational revolutionary wing to their organization as a class. If you look at the 30s, when socialists were leading the strike movement, where socialists were organizing the working class, go before the 30s to you know, the strike waves of 1919, the strike waves of the late 19th century. Many of the early organizers of the civil rights movement were you know, socialists or communists, and like making it very difficult for the capitalists to rule is the way that you successfully change things. And it is much more effective than coming, you know, building some kind of like relatively superficial unity with progressives who, if they're willing to vote in a positive way on an issue, you know, I will not criticize them for that. I will criticize them perhaps for something else, right? But we will have more strength as workers, as organizations, as socialists, to the extent that we independently draw away from what the capitalists want and how they want to rule. I'll just give one example, the airport protests, right? The airport protests were civil disobedience, and they forced the governor of New York to open up the airports to more civil disobedience. They forced judges to say, there's gotta be a restraining order, or whatever the term is, on this rule blocking immigrants from coming into the country. They gave the Democrats caution that they couldn't actually let this slide, and you started to see Democrats who had no interest, didn't care at all about this issue, like Schumer, right, come out then, because they didn't want to let the masses lose them, right? They didn't want people to get away and say the Democratic Party is certainly part of the problem. Of course it is, but they'll do what they can to make that not appear. So I think that's the way we want to organize the resistance to actually be successful.
All right, well, one more round of questions, then we'll give it a last comments from our panelists. Back here.
Down to Sal again. My first job out of high school, I was a printer's apprentice, setting lead type. Within a year of being there, the first computer came out that set lead type. I lost my job. I went on to become a carpenter, and I figured, well, nobody's going to replace carpenters. But the other day I saw a picture of a robot literally printing a house with concrete. And it's robots, the capitalists are very opposed to robots paying taxes. But if they replace the workers, who's going to pay the income tax? My point is there are many changes happening in our world that I don't see the old socialist doctrines reflecting. I was working with another socialist party for a while in the last few years, and they wanted to bring back coal mining and they thought they could light the 30% of the world that doesn't have electricity. They thought they could light it with coal. And, you know, it's just like, I don't see modern socialists addressing the issue of climate change. I barely see our Green Party addressing the issue of climate change. We're all, you know, the waterfront's going to be on the back of this building in another few years. The biggest mass movement that I've participated in recent years was the march in New York City with 500,000 people, whatever. We're not talking about these things that are going to affect all of us. We need to update our theory too.
Mm-hmm. Right. Anybody that came in and hasn't had a chance? Okay, Ian?
I mean, I kind of want to respond to what you said. I mean, I think that, it's been kind of a joke for a while, but in terms of at least the automation, I actually agree with you that the climate change stuff, that's what keeps me up at night. Like, climate change, that's the scary stuff. But I think that with only capitalism, I think the only way of organizing production where automation is a bad thing. Like, if we had a society which actually prioritized human needs, you know, automation would be a chance that less people have to be doing kind of carpentry, more people would be getting an education and doing the kind of like, and we'd be freeing more and more people from drudgery and getting more and more people on like the serious issues like climate change, getting people educations. and that could be like you know, fully automated luxury communism.
Right, so we've got two more questions here, right here. Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Danny, I'm with Mars. So I have a question for Michael, which was kind of implicit in something that Jack said earlier about how the Democratic Party has this pattern of moving things to the right instead of the left, right? I think you would probably argue that you support the Democrats because you see them as an effective check on the right. But as the past few months have shown us, the Democrats seem to be, and this forms the background of this whole talk, that the Democrats seem to be pretty incapable of doing that. For instance, supporting a lot of Trump's cabinet appointments, Obama providing a so-called successful transition to the Trump administration, even intervening at some minuscule level, like preventing someone slightly more left, like Keith Ellison, from getting Democratic National Party chair. So the Democratic Party has this moniker of graveyard of social movements, right? So if we were dedicated to building a social movement or a party or whatever to move this country, the world, whatever, towards the left, then why do you advocate a strategy of going into a party which has a history and a reputation of doing the exact opposite?
Yeah, we're talking about electoral politics today. And so, I was trying to limit my view to, I mean, if a viable third party emerged and gained power, I would join it. How's this for a response in terms of elections? Bush versus Gore. Okay. You know, Al Gore was one of what Adolf Reed called the Confederate twins, right? Clinton and Gore. I don't like Al Gore. Nader's in the race. Al Gore loses. And that's the dilemma. 6 million people are dead who wouldn't otherwise be dead because George Bush was president. Al Gore wouldn't have done Iraq. And his ilk, they wouldn't have done it. I don't care what you say. They wouldn't have fabricated, they would not have fabricated the causes for war and invade and poured gasoline on the Middle East. Al Gore and his minions, who are corporate, all corporate liberals, they would not have done that. So it is a dilemma. And I think a conservative number is about 5 to 6 million people are dead as a result of that invasion and occupation of Iraq. I told you I didn't like my position. I started with that. You know, this is my intuition about what's least bad, and I agree with everything you said. I mean, there have been all these promising moments. I was even hopeful about Obama in 2008. I still owe a hardcore socialist a night of drinking because I thought he might go the populist route, and something would be some kind of Roosevelt moment with him. And you were saying this, right?
Absolutely.
A liberal technocrat on day one. Boom. Gone. Over. From hope to nope. You can go back to the 84, you know, the Jackson moment in 84 was one of these promising moments. That was a sort of a little bit of a different, anyway, I'm old enough to remember this stuff, and you're right. I don't have an answer. I mean, I just don't think third parties are, it's sort of it's structurally a non-starter when you're trying to start. So, Bernie Sanders' robust welfare state just makes more sense to me as a pragmatic answer to what you do about electoral politics tomorrow. That's it.
Yeah, before I give my final answer, I just wanted to make an announcement that the magazine that was circulated at Mass Strike is a magazine of another organization, the International Luxembourgist Network. Not to be confused with the Movement for Socialism, but that does share many of the same goals. Just one comment on Democrats as peace candidates. The last Democratic presidential candidate that I supported, I was too young to vote for him, but I did campaign for him, was Lyndon Johnson. He campaigned as a peace candidate. So I would question the Democrats as the Peace Party. I wanted to respond to the question about socialists and energy. In my day job, I am president and chief scientist of a firm called LPP Fusion. We're working to develop a form of fusion energy. That's the energy that powers the sun. That would be not only clean, no greenhouse gases, but would also be 10 times cheaper than any existing power. That would put the oil and gas companies out of business. We strongly advocate, and I think any socialist organization should strongly advocate, a vast increase in the funding that goes to clean energy research. This is a technologically solvable problem, and we can get rid of not only the threat of climate change, but the much more immediate threat of 7 million people around the world who are dying each year due to carbon-based pollution. I also think that, you know, we're talking about in a program of mass increase of a publicly funded infrastructure program, which obviously Mr. Trump will never arrive at, of a reduction in hours that takes advantage of advances in automation. I mean, if you graph the number of hours that full-time workers work in the United States from the 1890s to the 1945, that graph went down very steeply. Then it leveled off, and then in the 1970s it turned around and started going back up during a period in which clearly technology and automation is advancing. If we fully implement technology, we could reduce hours of work first to 35, then to 30, and eventually to 25, which is what you would get if you extended that line. So, absolutely, a socialist program means implementing and using technology to benefit the working class, not the capitalists.
So first I'll respond to the matter of the Democrats and the Republicans, and I certainly don't think that the Democrats are an anti-war party. But I think that the larger issue is that the two parties and any capitalist parties, any parties that seek to preserve and make capitalism work better, will be in a mutually dependent relationship. But there's a bit of a division of labor. So the Democrats and Republicans are kind of, they're two sides of the same coin. Sort of the Republicans exist to be the hard line of capitalism, to do awful things when they can get away with it, you know, and that happens when people aren't mobilized. It happens when people aren't prepared to resist, which is usually the consequence of them starting to work within the Democratic Party. The Democratic Party, on the other hand, comes to power when it seems like there needs to be some kind of solution, right? It seems like too many people are resisting. For example, in about 2006 to 2008, there was a huge anti-war movement. There was a huge immigrants movement, right? Many of those movements turned to Obama, right? And what happened? You know, the largest deporter continued the wars, right? It's a system, right? So let me move on to the question about Donald, is your name? The economy?
Yeah.
John, I'm sorry. Okay. Yes, climate change is one of the most pressing issues of humanity, of even beyond humanity, if you will. I think only a socialist society can actually resolve the problems of climate change. Capitalism in the United States is, in a certain sense, in crisis. The rate of profit has been falling. There's been economic crises, financial crises, and so forth. These will continue, but capitalism will try to survive by eating up the environment, basically, and by eating up workers' wages and by driving people into a lower and lower state of existence. And as far as they're concerned, that can go on quite a while because there are always nice places for capitalists to live, protected by guards. On the other hand, you know, humanity does have the problem, the capacity to resolve these problems through some of the technologies Eric mentioned, but also through organization, an international organization. And that's why we think that it's very important for us to study the economy. Socialists should be very active working on that, and that's something that Mars actually does. We are very concerned with the issues of imperialism and the massive development of industry and manufacturing in other parts of the world, including China, and that is now where the largest working class in world history lives, using some of the most advanced technologies that the working class has ever had. And I think that's a very hopeful prospect, actually, for internationalism and socialism, right? And we should not deceive ourselves that America is the most important country, or that it is the ultimate basis of humanity's future through solving our political problems or correcting environmental problems. What we should be is internationalists. We should be sympathetic and fighting actually to help revolutions succeed in other countries. So I'll end it.
Okay. Let's give the panelists one more opportunity, maybe a minute or two, to respond to the central question of this forum, which way forward on elections.
I honestly don't have anything more to
say,
so I'll pass.
I just have one thing to say. Something that you said, just as you were talking about, when does it make sense for a third party to be in there or not, and at what level? I wrestle with this too. A lot of people have said to me, why don't you first build a movement of running for smaller offices before you try for governor? I do think that's a fair question. Level of position should a third party run for? It's a fair question. And I think that in certain elections, stakes are higher than others and different than others. I myself feel that running for governor is the perfect spot for a legitimate third party, or as I call them, first party option, to give it a try. Because it's large enough to make a difference, but it's not going to put us in Iraq if a mistake is wrong. It's not the president. Just in terms of responding to you, real, gigantic change can happen at the level of a governor being outside the system.
I admire what you're doing, and I hope you do make it to be present for debates.
Yeah.
I don't know what exactly is required for that, but I think that would
money.
Be great.
That's it.
Gee, I didn't bring my checkbook.
What a crazy criteria.
Yeah, they said it themselves.
It's
$430,000.
It can sometimes be great for the third party to be in there articulating the position, the arguments, and calling people on stuff. But
And if it results in a Republican winning, I would say, so be it. That's what happens when there's viable, legitimate, super strong progressive movement. It's time for things to hit the fan in a real, real serious way. And hopefully it won't, that won't be the result. But if that happens, so be it. We don't have to, if we're always worried about the end game, we're never going to try anything new.
Okay, but so it's not really fair to talk about Ralph Bader or Jill Stein as leading to a worse outcome by drawing votes away from, the lesser of two evils, in your view. Right, we have two evils, but one is certainly more evil than the other.
Right.
Trump, Clinton, Bush, Gore, and there's a third party candidate in there who has, some power. Jill Stein, ran well and got support, and
right.
Nader sure as hell did.
Right.
In 2000.
I would say in terms of Nader, to connect his his running with millions of deaths in the Middle East because of a war that had started is a little bit of a I don't think that's fair to that's a big accusation.
I didn't accuse him of causing the war.
Right.
I just said that had Gore won the point is simple.
That's true.
Oh, it matters, right? It matters whether Gore or Bush wins. However much you hate Gore and the Democratic Party, it matters.
But also, who supported that war?
Win.
Was it just Bush?
No, of course
right.
not. Of course not.
Was the whole Democrat, plenty of the Democrats.
I am committed to the proposition, and who knows, it's a counterfactual, that given what I know about Gore and the foreign policy people around him, they wouldn't have fabricated that
and I would
invasion.
Agree with that.
Well, I would totally disagree, and I think history.
No, you're still militaristic.
I think history completely completely undercuts the Democratic Party as the party of peace.
I didn't say they were the party of peace. I said they wouldn't have done the Iraq War. That's all I said.
I think that
you
there
said
was,
even just they wouldn't have fabricated
that. There was ruling class unity.
That particular war.
Piece of it.
But
the weapons of mass destruction piece.
You know, I think that there's no question that the Democrats and Republicans in opposition have different rhetoric. But I think the Democrats and Republicans in power have extremely similar policies. Obama did not prosecute anyone for torture. He did not actually close Guantanamo. He didn't reverse really any of the Republican policies. So I think in power the Democrats look a lot like the Republicans. What I would like to conclude on is again saying I think there is actually, from what I hear, a certain amount of unity in the room, and I urge people who think they can work together on a concept somewhat similar to what I've been talking about for 2018, that we talk about forming a committee to work towards that on a regional basis. Thanks.
Just responding to points. So on the Iraq War, of course it is a counterfactual, but there's actually now some historical scholarship that indicates that Clinton and Gore as vice president were more or less planning to eventually have Iraq War. Maybe they would have done it in what they would consider a more beneficial way for U.S. imperialism, but I think there could very well have been a war, if there was not a war, there certainly would have been other wars by the U.S. or by Democrats that would have been even more possible by some other difference in policy, so to speak.
There's always been U.S. The U.S. has been intervening in other countries for, you know, 100 or more. I mean, yeah, there are always interventions in wars. We're always doing that.
So,
is about that one.
One phrase I like the quote is that the Democrats are not the lesser evil, they're the more effective evil. And they're very effective at a particular thing, which is co-opting social movements and getting people to say, like, well, if there is a lesser evil, it's very important just this time that we don't, allow this to happen. It's an exceptional circumstance.